Hey there, this is René Molenaar, creator of networklessons.com. And in this video, we'll talk about IP, the Internet Protocol. So there's a couple of things we have to discuss. And let's start at the top. First of all, IP, it lives at the network layer. So that's layer 3 of the OSI model. It's connectionless. And what that means is that IP does not establish a connection. Yeah? You need a transport layer protocol to establish the connection. So for example, TCP, it establishes a connection. So the transport layer is for the transport of the data, but IP is just a packet. So to put things into perspective, you could say that IP is like an envelope. The data is the letter that you put in the envelope, but you still need a postal service to deliver your envelope. Yeah? And the postal service, that could be the transport layer protocol. So it doesn't create any connections. Hierarchical, now what that means we'll discuss in a bit. And an IP address is 32 bits. Now, let me show you what that looks like. If you have a 32-bit value, if you convert it into a decimal value, then you get a really large number. So instead, we chop the 32 bits that we have into 4 pieces. Of 8 bits each. So 8 bits. 8 bit is a byte, so we got 4 bytes over here. And in total, that gives us a 32-bit IP address. So 32 bits. Now, why do we use 4 times 8 bits? It's because we can make some easier to read numbers. So to give you an example, let's say we have this IP address. 192.168.1.1. Yeah? This is an IP address, so we got 4 bytes over here. This is an easy to read number. Yeah? Let's take a look at an example of what this looks like in binary. Yeah? So what we need to do is we got value 192. And let's take a look what it looks like in binary. Now, if you haven't done any binary calculations yet, then it's easy to write down some values. 8, 4, 2, 1. So these are, let's put some space in between. So these are the 8 bits that we have. Yeah? Now, if I want to convert 192 into binary, then it would look like this. 128 plus 64, that would be 192. Yeah? So, this over here is 192 in binary. Now, if you look at 168, what does it look like in binary? 128, if you would add 64, it would be too much. So let's add 32, that gives us 160. This would be too much, but if we add 8, then we have 168. Yeah? So it would be 128 there we go. 128 plus 32 plus 8 is 168. Yeah? And the one that's an easy one in binary, that would look like this. There we go. So this is our 32-bit IP address in binary. Yeah? So now you know what it looks like. And the next thing we'll talk about is this. Each IP address has a network and a host part. Yeah? So let me explain it. Let's get rid of this over here. Let's remove this as well. So let's clean up a bit. Okay. So each IP address it has a network part So we have the network part and we have a host part. Yeah? Okay. So to give you an example, let's use the IP address that I just showed you. There we go. So, for example, for 192.168.1.1, the 192.168.1 part, this over here, this is the network part, and the one is the host part. Yeah. So this tells us the network that we're talking about, and this address over here it will identify the host. Yeah. So 192.168.1.1 could be a host address, and 1.2 could be another host. And both of those will be in the 192.168.1 network. Yeah? Okay. Now, something we have to discuss now is how do we know which part is the network part and what part is the host part? So we got 32 bits for an IP address. Why is this the network part and why is this the host part? Yeah? Now, maybe you probably configured an IP address before. You might have seen this. So we got an IP address. But if you configure an IP address, you also have to configure a subnet mask. And the subnet mask, if you configured this IP address before, would look like this. .255.255.255.0. Yeah? Now, what this subnet mask does is it will tell us which part of this IP address is the network part and which part is the host part. Yeah? Now, the word mask is a bit confusing because it might sound like it's hiding something, but that's not what the subnet mask does. It tells us which is the network part of the address and which part is the host address. Yeah? Now, how does it work? What do we see here? And to explain this, I have to show you a couple of binary values again. So let's get rid of this. And let's take a look at this address again. And let me write it down in binary again. There we go. So this is 192.168.1.1. This is the IP address in binary. Now let me write down the subnet mask. So for example, 255.255.255.0. Yeah. Now in binary it looks like this. So there's a lot of drawing going on here. There we go. This is what the subnet mask looks like in binary. It's just a lot of ones and then we get some zeros. Yeah. Now, how does the subnet mask work? When we use a one over here, then it means that it's the network address. Yeah? So we got this whole string of ones, and then suddenly we get all these zeros over here. What does it mean? If you look at it like this, I can draw a line here. Where we have all these ones, it means that this is the network part. So this over here is the network part. And when we see the zeros for the subnet mask, that means that these bits can be used for hosts. Yeah? So this over here, that's the network part. This is the network part. And this is the host part. Yeah? So, network part, host part. So this is what the subnet mask does. So the subnet mask tells us which is the what is the network part and what is the host part. Okay. So let's take a look. So we talked about the network layer. This is on the network layer. Connectionless, I talked about this. I'll save this for a minute. 32 bits. And we talked about the network and host part. Okay, so the next thing we should talk about is we have a network part and there's a broadcast part. Now, what does this mean? When you look at this host part over here, in this case we got 8 bits. So there are 8 bits you can play with for hosts. Yeah? Now, there is an exception to this rule. Yeah? There are 2 addresses of the host part that we cannot use. If I set all these host bits to 0, then that's the network address and we can't use it. So for example, 192.168.1.0 would be my network address. Yeah? So let me write that down. 168.1.0. This is my network address. We can't use it. Yeah? So if you set the host bit to 0, that's the network address. So in this example, that would be 192.168.1.0. Yeah? The other address that I can't use is the broadcast address. And the broadcast address is something that if you send something to the broadcast address, then all hosts within the network will receive that broadcast packet. Yeah? How does it work? If you set the host bits all to 1, then you have your broadcast address. Yeah? So that would look like this. So I'm setting them all to 1, and if I set them all to 1, then the decimal value would be 255. Yeah? So it would look like this, 192.168.1.255. That is my broadcast address. There we go. So these are 2 addresses that we can't use. Yeah? The host bits all set to 0, that's the network address. The host bits all set to 1, then you have a broadcast address. Okay. So that's the network and the broadcast address. So we got that one. What else do we have? Classes. There's something called class A, B, and C. And let's get rid of this. So I got some extra space. So the example that I just gave you with this address, with this subnet mask, this is an example of a class C network. Now, what does this mean? We have different classes, and these classes tell us how large the network is and how many hosts we can have for each network. Yeah? So we got a class A, B, and C. Now, and what it looks like is this. So we got an IP address, which is 32 bits, 4 times 8 bits. When we use class A, then it looks like this. The first 8 bits are the network address, and the rest is for hosts. Yeah? So if you would use a class A network, then you can put a lot of hosts into a single network. Okay? If we look at class B, then it would look like this. The first 2 bytes define the network. And the last 2 bytes tell us how many hosts we can have for each network. Yeah. So class B is a little bit smaller than class A. And the last one, class C, well, I already gave you the answer, but it looks like this. So the first 3 bytes are for the network address, and the last byte is for hosts. Yeah. So with class C, we can have many different networks, but only a few hosts for each network. Yeah. Okay. So how many hosts can you put into each network? Well, to give you an example for the class C, we have 8 bits. So 1 byte, you got 8 bits over here. 3, 4. And with 8 bits, we can create up to 256 different addresses. Yeah? So let me give you an example. Let's just write down the bits again. 64, 32, 16, 8, 4, 2, 1. Yeah? So we got 8 bits over here. And if I set all of those to 1, so 128 plus 64 plus 32 plus 16 plus 8 plus 4 plus 2 plus 1. If you add all of those together, then the value that you end up with is 255. But I said you can have 256 different addresses. And that's because we start counting not at 1, but we start counting at 0. Yeah? So, for example, 192.168.1.1 is an address that we can use for a host, but we start with 1.0, which is the network address. Yeah? So in total, we have 256 possible addresses because we start counting at the 0. Yeah? Keep in mind, I say 256 addresses, but since we can't use the network address, the first address, and we also can't use the broadcast address, the last one, in total, we have 254 addresses that we can use for computers, yeah? Or routers, or anything you you want. Okay, so those are the different classes that we have. And we just talked about the subnet mask, but in case you're wondering, class A, network, and then host, host, host. So what it would look like, the subnet mask would be this, 255, and for class B, And for class C, it would look like this. Yeah? So these are the subnet masks that we use for the different classes that we have. Yeah? Now this whole idea of class ABC, it's a bit old, because nowadays we can create smaller networks if we want, or larger networks, whatever. But this is something we'll talk about when we're discussing subnetting and some binary calculations. So don't worry about it for now. The last thing I want to talk about is this, the public and private addresses. But there's one thing else we have to discuss when it comes to the classes. There are some fixed ranges, and let me explain this. So let's get rid of this. So there are some fixed ranges when it comes to class A, B and C. Yeah. Okay, so when we use class A, there's a rule, and it says that the first bit always has to be a zero. Yeah. So the first bit has to be a zero. When we look at class B, the first two bits always have to be one and zero. Yeah. And for class C, the first three bits have to be 1, 1, 0. Yeah. Now, when we convert this from binary to decimal, we get this. So zero is easy. We start with zero. Class B, the first bit has to be a one, so that's 128. So class B, it starts at 128. And class C has to start with 1, 1, 0. Yeah, 128, this one stands for 64. So class C, it starts with 192. Yeah. So this is where they start. And you can see, since class C starts at 192, it means that class B ends at, so it ends at 191, 255. Yeah, so technically class B starts at 128 and it ends at 191, 255, 255, 255, because the next address is class C. Yeah. So this is how you can tell if you have an IP address, you can tell to which class that it belongs. Yeah. So let's fill in the other things that we have. Normally, class A would end at 127. Yeah, because class B, it starts with 128. But there is an exception to this range, since 127, this entire range is used for loopback. So if you start your computer and you do something like ping 127.0.0.1, you will probably get a response, because this is reserved for the loopback. And it's used to test if the network stack is operating. Yeah? So the entire 127 range, you can't use it for computers or routers or whatever. Yeah? So the class A range, it starts at 0. And it ends at 126, 255, like this. Yeah? And the last one, class C, so where does it end? Well, technically, there is a class D. And class D has to start with the first, second and third bit set to 1. And then a zero. And the value you get then in decimal is 224. Class D is reserved for multicast. Now, multicast is something that it's not on the CCNA routing and switching exam. So we won't talk about it much, but it starts with 224, which means that class C ends at 223. There we go. So class C starts with 192 and it ends with 223, 255, 255, 255. Okay, so these are the classes. And now you also know how you can tell if you have an IP address to which class that it belongs. Yeah? Keep in mind the whole thing with the classes, we don't really use it anymore because we have something called variable length subnet mask, and we'll talk about this later. But it means that we can use, we don't have to stick to these default classes anymore. Yeah? Okay, so the classes, we talked about that. The last thing that we have are the public and private IP addresses. Yeah. The public IP addresses, those are the addresses that we can use on the internet. Yeah. And the private IP addresses, those are for your local area networks. Yeah. And you shouldn't be using any private IP addresses on devices that are connected to the internet. And of course, you shouldn't be using public IP addresses on your local area networks. Yeah. So, now the question remains, which addresses are private? And we have a couple of ranges for this. So, for class A, we have the 10 range. So, the entire 10 range is a private IP address space, yeah, within class A. When we look at class B, 16, 172.16 up to 172.32, this is the private range for class B. Yeah? And when we look at class C, the entire 192.168 space is used for private addresses. Yeah? And this one is probably familiar since it's very common on local area networks. So that's basically it. So this is an introduction to IP, the Internet Protocol. I hope this has been useful. Thanks for watching this video. And in some other videos, I will explain some of these things into some more detail. So thanks for watching, and till next time.